can't believe it. I thought surely I'd lost you by now. But your heart, it's still beating. Faint, gentle, bitter patter. Open your eyes. Can you do that for me? I know it's hard. Open your eyes. Open your eyes. Ah, there you are. Still that delicate sparkle in those eyes. Oh, barely. What a sturdy thing you must be. Yet, here you are, still desperately clinging to life, dangling from the edge of a cliff by your claws. I just might be impressed, but not quite yet. There, there, it's all right. Shh, stop struggling. You don't have the strength for it. It's no use. You're mine. I've imagined so many times what it would be like to have you down here all to myself. I've been watching you for weeks now. Did you ever suspect it? I wondered if you had any inkling at all of my gaze burning into you. I don't think you did. Every night, watching from afar as you waited for your train, it's been so enjoyable. Admiring the contours of your lovely face. Your habit of fiddling with your watch. Checking the time again and again. Nervously shifting your weight from side to side. Polite smiles acknowledging others. Best of all, best of all, was when the wind tousled your hair, sweeping it aside to reveal fleeting glimpses of your beautiful neck just for me. I nearly made my move so many times, but always at the last moment. Some witness would arrive, or your train would come just in time to snatch you away from me. I resented it, but also felt happy for you somehow. Pleased at the thought of you arriving home safe, enjoying your dinner. Watching a movie, sleeping deeply, all the while blissfully unaware of me, of my intentions with you. It's a delicious treat, stalking oblivious prey. I'd scold you for lacking awareness of your surroundings. I am terribly stealthy, terribly patient. It'd be unfair blaming you. To stay safe from me, You needed to be lucky every single night to get you. I only needed to be lucky once. I'd hoped you would follow me here of your own accord. A public feed is a risky endeavor. Best to be avoided whenever possible. Things were going so well. I was thoroughly enjoying our conversation. You seemed to be too. I couldn't wait to walk here with you happily following along like a loyal pup. But then I spotted it, a flicker of hesitation in your eyes, of primal fear. That pesky little gut feeling you humans seem to get at the most inopportune of times. That sinking feeling in your stomach, chill running down your spine, hairs standing up on the back of your neck, every fiber of your being begging you to run away. I couldn't risk you running away. Not when everything was going so wonderfully. Not with you smelling so irresistible. I couldn't help but sink my teeth in right then and there. I'm sure you understand. I drank and drank as you fell limp. Once I was satisfied, I slung your arm over my shoulder and helped you stumble along the street. In your half-consciousness, you were making these pleading eyes at passerbys, but they all assumed you'd simply drink yourself silly. Poor thing. When we arrived, you were shivering. Your nice coat, it had gotten all wet. So, I bundled you up in dry clothes, fresh linens, fine furs, and lit the fireplace. I hope you're much more comfortable now. Oh, there, there. It's all right. I know just what you feel. I've experienced exactly what you're experiencing right now. You're feeling weaker and weaker as your precious mortal life slips away from you, as the color drains from your face. You feel a strange, numb tingling all over, chilled by the knowledge that no matter what you do, you cannot stop your life from draining away. You're wondering, what was it you were supposed to be doing tonight? It's hard to remember now. Why aren't you out at the bar, drinking your rum and coke, enjoying the music, chatting with friendly strangers? Everyone else is up there, laughing and dancing. How did you end up down here? A hopelessly entangled in a spider's web. You're completely cocooned, and you never even fought back. How did this happen? Surely, when you awoke this morning, you could have never imagined. Every last trace of warmth your body harbors is flowing out from your heart, drifting up and out from your chest. That precious golden energy flowing. Disappearing into nothingness. You're paralyzed by your weakness. Your complete and utter helplessness. You're frozen, glued to the spot. That radiant life force that once kept your body supported and full dissolves away, leaving you heavier and heavier, your arms drooping uselessly, your legs sinking down, down, down. An immense weight pulling you down, as if the very dirt itself is calling your name. What to do? What an awful waste it would be for you to die. Perhaps you might manage to make it through this. Somehow, miraculously, your body could manage to replace enough of the blood I've stolen from you. In which case, naturally, I'd keep you captive here. My personal blood bag. Mine to feed upon again. I don't typically prefer to keep pets. Humans are such troublesome company. But I've taken a liking to you. I like you more and more every moment. If you can believe it. I'm sure this treatment hasn't seemed I do apologize. Not for my actions, but for the cruel manner of the natural world. The inherent order of things. It's by no fault of your own that you were born as prey. And no fault of mine that I was turned predator long ago. Do you say, my delicate little beastie? Would you like to be turned predator too? To feel your pathetically feeble form invigorated with power? A second life? superior to the first in every way you could possibly imagine. Without me, the dirt would have its way and swallow you whole, absorbing you in its relentless churning consumption. But I can save you from that fate. I'm here for you. I'm here to hold you close, to support your infinite weight as every trace of life leaves you. Proves that you are deserving. Proves that I must feed you the precious cherry droplets of immortality. You see, it's not quite enough for me to simply bite you. Drink of my blood. Drink. Good. Taste the thrilling spark of hot, salty blood on your cold tongue. Breathing life back into your mind, your lungs, your veins, a beautiful white flower blossoms from your chest, glowing emerald vines reaching out over your body, soft leafy tendrils curling around you gently. Now filled with a newfound power, strength, and peace, more profound than you have ever known. Feel this warmth spreading through your chest, warmth gliding down your spine, as my blood breathes new life through your arms. Through your legs, down to the toes. An ecstasy washes over you, a complete calm filling your senses. No doubts, no worries, no uncertainties to be found. You know wholeheartedly you are strong, safe, and loved. You have, at long last, finally found your perfect place in all the world. Whatever dull, dismal future awaited you, it matters no longer. No need to trouble yourself with the murky uncertainties of that life you've left behind. Now, your time is infinite. Your power, indescribable. Every corner of this earth that interests you is yours to explore. Every piece of literature your curiosity, your knowledge to consume. Each artwork you desire to breathe life to. all of history's masterpieces of composition, your melodies to lose yourself within, the finest silks yours to savor, every sparkling jewel yours to appreciate. And desire nothing more than to treat you to every finery you crave, my dear, my sweet, precious flower. I'd been lonely for so long, I'd lost hope to ever find the right creature to share this existence. But waiting by those tracks, hunting for my next meal, I saw the potential for the perfect companion. And now you've proven to me, without a doubt, that you possess the strength, the determination, love for life that I so value. In your voice, I hear the tender soul that has eluded me for so long. In your eyes, I see such deep kindness. I know that there could be no other more perfectly suited. I'm so pleased to have preserved your form just as it was when I first spotted you. Never to be ravaged by the cruelties of time. Never to decay. Forever frozen in this flawless state for me to gaze upon. Never will I tire of this faultless form. You'll need to stay locked away here for the time being, for your own safety. Den will be your safe haven. Oh, dear. You have become somewhat disheveled from your ordeal. Not to worry. I will clean you up and decorate you properly. Let's start with your hair. We'll need to untangle these knots. They formed from your understandable writhing throughout the process of the transformation. Quite a peculiar sensation, I admit. Just for this. makeup will be necessary to create the illusion of mortal life. We can't have you attracting too many stares once you head out into the wild. Don't worry about hunting for the time being. You're far too young. For now, I will provide all the blood you'll need. And in time, when you are ready, I will teach you how to stalk, how to lure, how to feed. It's a delicate art, but if attempted young, too aggressively, you might get us into a tricky situation that can be troublesome to escape. But so long as you listen to my every word, follow my every instruction, things will be perfect, I can promise you that. Nothing to worry about at all. I am here to take care of you, to take care of every last thing for you. No more troubles, my dear. Plenty of fragrance will be necessary as well, given that vampires do lack scent entirely. Very beneficial when it comes to the hunt, but unnerving to humans. A lack of fragrance isn't the sort of thing anyone would consciously note, but on some deeper, more instinctual level, they'll know that something is not quite right about you. You look even more stunning than before. I can't help but marvel at your newfound beauty. Strength. It's hard to believe that so recently you had that ghostly pallor and were so weak you could hardly breathe. Now you seem to embody vitality itself. Welcome to immortality. I have a few things I'd like to show you. All priceless treasures I've collected over the centuries. This necklace belonged to Marie Antoinette. I stole it before she lost her head. When I was a young vampire, I was eager to explore my potential. I passed the days and delighted myself through the nights by thieving glittering jewels from wealthy ladies. Such a thrill, evading capture, always dancing on the cusp of detection, but slipping out of grasp at the last moment. One night, I found myself wandering the streets of Paris, drawn to the opulent beauty of the royal palace. As I approached, I noted the guards patrolling the gates, but undeterred, I snuck past, slipping into the palace gardens unnoticed. I strolled about, following the meandering paths of finely laid cobblestones, lined with meticulously manicured hedges, trimmed to perfection. I admired the spectacular beauty of the gardens, flower beds overflowing with daffodils, tulips, and perfect pink roses, each bloom swaying with the breeze as though dancing along to an invisible melody. The harsh noise of city life was muted entirely in this sanctuary, replaced with the soothing sounds of fountains cascading with crystal clear waters. The air was cool and crisp, a fragrant symphony of gorgeous young woman perched on a bench, gazing out at the centerpiece of the garden, a pristine, shimmering lake, its mirror-like surface reflecting the starry night sky, decorated with floating water lilies and gracefully gliding swans. The scent that had guided me through the gardens emanated from her powerfully, an intoxicating blend of the delicate perfumes she'd adorned herself with, and her blood. I quickly recognized her as Marie Antoinette, the Queen of France. Her gown was enormous, cumbersome layers of pink satin, hemmed in white lace, embellished in pearls. Her hair was styled in an elaborate updo, soft curls framing her face, intricate braids woven in. Her skin was pale and flawless, her cheeks flushed, a tempting hint of the warm blood waiting for me just beneath the surface. Her eyes were piercing blue, framed in delicate brows and thick lashes. Her lips were painted in a doll-like shape in a soft shade of pink. Despite her grandeur, she had a youthfulness about her, a vulnerability that made her all the more alluring. As I crept closer, I noticed the strand of gorgeous pearls wrapped around her pretty neck. I couldn't resist the temptation of the gorgeous necklace, a suitable addition to my fledgling collection of treasures, nor the temptation to taste her royal blood. I decided to reveal myself, stepping out from the shadows onto the moonlit cobblestones. Hearing my footsteps, she She stared, frozen, like a startled deer. I flashed her a wicked smile, revealing my sharp teeth. She went pale and began to tremble in fear. Her peaceful enjoyment of an evening alone in the gardens quickly turning to terror. I inched closer and closer, relishing every drop of her fear and desperation. There's something so special about those delicate moments before feeding. As life hangs in the balance, a certain beauty in the way that humans react to their impending doom. Their profound love for their life laid bare before them, nearly invisible before, but now clear as day as they face losing it all in an instant. That raw vulnerability is thrilling to witness, made all the more exhilarating by the knowledge that I am the cause, that I hold their life in my hands. As I sank my teeth into her neck, her blood was unlike anything I'd ever tasted before. Sweet and heady, with a hint of lavender. I drank deeply, savoring every last bit. I felt her life force flowing into me. I unclasped her necklace and released her. She dropped weak. I slipped away from the gardens, disappearing into the night, satiated and looking lovely in my new necklace. This hairpin is from the Qing Dynasty. It was worn by the Empress herself. One night, I was seeking shelter from a storm, in search of a warm and dry place to rest. I found myself sneaking into the Imperial Palace. I roamed the halls, filled to the brim with extravagant sculptures, paintings, and tapestries. I eventually stumbled upon the room where the Empress was resting. An intricately carved wooden headboard inlaid with mother of pearl. Sumptuous green silk blankets with a matching canopy draped overhead. Endless pillows. The Empress laid delicately within this opulent nest, dressed in golden silk robes. I admired my prey. I couldn't wait to feast on her blood. Nothing could be more comforting to my cold bones than a warm drink. Shoe seek in my chambers. I hesitated, finding her lack of fear offensive, yet intriguing. My eyes trailed up towards the pin, resting in her hair. Her gaze followed mine. She freed the pin from its place and held it out to me gingerly. I slipped it into my pocket and bowed low, expressing my gratitude. She then tilted her head to the side, revealing her neck. I dove into a bite, feeding eagerly, but with an unprecedented restraint. I don't know if it was her kindness or her lack of fear that inspired me to drink so little, but I knew I had to ensure she would survive this feeding. Still hungry, I disappeared silently. Grateful for her generosity, perplexed by her bravery, and resolving to watch my step more carefully in the future. This music box was made by a skilled craftsman in Switzerland, the town of Engelberg in particular, a quaint village tucked amongst the hills, known for its stunning waterfalls and endless fields of wildflowers. I resided there humbly for some time, viewed with scorn by most of the villagers who suspected I was responsible for the strange goings-on since my arrival. She was on the brink of death after suffering a terrible fall. He'd heard rumors of what I was and begged me to save her life by granting her the same immortal life as mine. I obliged his desperate request on the condition that he reward me with a small token of gratitude. He agreed. I fed upon her and allowed her to drink of my blood, and thus she was able to carry on. He kept up his end of the bargain and gifted me this beautiful music box that plays a melody he would sing his daughter. Your watch. May I add it to my collection? A memento to commemorate the night you became mine. Thank you, my dear. I will treasure it forever. It's been a long pleasure-filled life. Which may from every sin.